All right, going to page four, conducting closed session meetings. This is the beauty of this group. I'm gonna skip right past this. We're not gonna go into closed sessions because y'all don't have any reason to have a closed session. Go to page six. Open Records Act, not gonna spend a whole lot of time here just to tell you that the Open Records Act is like the Open Meetings Act, and that is, it is a statute that will be strictly construed in favor of revealing documents. So if there's a gray area, we don't know whether it's an open record or not, we don't know whether it really complies with county government or not, and you're trying to balance, let me just tell you where the thumb is gonna be on, it's gonna come out then. Because if it's a gray area, it comes out, because the Open Records Act too, like the Open Meetings Act, was designed to foster confidence in government and should be liberally construed to affect its remedial purpose. That means, in a close case, we lose not disclosing. You may ask what a public record is. What I typically tell people is, it's pretty much anything unless you can talk me out of it. It's a lot. It's hard copy, electronic data. It's reports, drafts, finals. It's email. It's electronic communications. So long as it's not the medium that is important, it is the subject matter of the medium that is important. If the document arises or pertains to the operation, scope, or course of county government operations of which you all are mired in as Planning Commission members, then it's going to be subject to the Act. I will only say this, we're not going to spend a lot of time on that because we've got great staff who handle open records. I handle open records if they apply to you in many instances. I will only say this, and again, this is a generic comment because I've not had a problem with this commission. This is what I say to everybody. People of sound mind and body that are reasonable, responsible people that go to church on Sunday are great folks, get behind a keyboard in an email and say things that are the gosh awfulest things I have ever seen in my entire life. So I would only say, keep your heads about you when you get behind a keyboard and write an email, because for some reason, people's brains eject right out of their head sometimes when they are behind a keyboard. And just be mindful, because electronic data lasts a long time. And it's there for years and years and years and years and years, and it is in fact subject to disclosure unless it falls within one of the narrowly tailored exceptions. Like attorney-client privilege, like certain personnel data, like social security numbers, like that sort of thing. So a lot of the stuff y'all are dealing with in the realm of zoning, no way, no how, that's exempt. It's coming out. So just be mindful of it. And again, not saying that this, because y'all have any problems with this at all. In fact, I've never seen anything out of this Planning Commission that's been the least bit problematic as far as an email, but I just say that to you. Don't worry about responding to Open Records Act requests. You all don't do this. I'm not even gonna talk about exemptions or record retention right now. Go to page 10. With respect to the authority and jurisdiction for zoning, I assume you all know this. I mean, the ultimate embodiment of the power of zoning comes from the Georgia Constitution. The local government's ability to zone property is a constitutional entitlement. Actually, that is only in the name of county government. Does everybody understand that? The General Assembly cannot act in the realm of zoning except procedurally. They cannot act substantively in the realm of zoning. That is, by the Georgia Constitution, something specifically provided to the local governments, which is why that the only place that the General Assembly have acted in the realm of zoning is the Zoning Procedures Act, because that's the only place they can operate. They've set these minimum standards for how zonings have to be conducted. But with respect to the meat and potatoes of what gets zoned when, that's in the province of the local government to set up you as the Planning Commission to be part of that process.
Just a curious question. Is that just Georgia, or is it a vary by state?
I think it's gonna vary state by state, but in Georgia, that's embodied in our Constitution. It's a great question. And if you were to ask me to name the 50 or 49 other derivations of that, I couldn't begin to. But in Georgia, it's sort of a neat thing. And that is embodied in our Constitution as a local power that we have. Again, with respect to your powers, unless you have specific questions about your powers, where they originate from, and sort of the legal presumptions that we would have in a courtroom, I'm not going to go into that, just because, call me, we can talk about it all day long, but that's not what I really thought I was here to go over with you. With respect to the art of making motions on page 13, again, I am not hearing specific concerns about this coming out of the Planning Commission, about whether y'all are having trouble making motions or uncomfortable making motions or want some guidance on making motions. I will only say this, I prefer that motions, particularly with respect to the zoning on recommendations, the closer you can tailor what you're doing to the specific guidelines in the Act of UDC, the better. You know, as you know, there's those general and special considerations in the UDC, things you're supposed to consider when you pass or deny or recommend or approve a zoning. I like it if you can embrace some of those in the actual motion that you make. For instance, if you say, I would move to recommend zoning application XXXX because, and then maybe identify even some of the criteria under the UDC by which you are making your recommendation, particularly if it's to deny. Because if it's to deny, obviously the likelihood is greater that there will be a challenge. If it's to approve, that likelihood goes away a little bit because, quite frankly, the applicant's probably not going to sue if you approve their zoning. And then what you've got is you've got maybe an adjacent property owner that would have standing to approve, but the standard to challenge a zoning by an adjacent property owner is much more onerous than it is of an applicant challenging a denial. You see what I'm saying? So it's when you're denying that I would certainly like to see one of those motions maybe articulate some of the bases from the UDC and some specific elements out of the UDC. So just a practice rule or pointer, if you will. I don't know if y'all do this anymore. And again, I have not come to Planning Commission meetings in a while, ever since Tom Brown kicked me out of the meeting. I'm just kidding. That's a joke. But I don't come anymore to the Planning Commission meetings. So I do have to ask a question. And the question is, when you all are putting your conditions in, are we still putting in conditions that mimic UDC prohibitions anyway? We used to do that a lot, and I wonder if we did it anymore. You know what I'm talking about, Tom, where we will put in a list of like eight? Yeah, where we duplicate the UDC?
We try our best to avoid that.
Okay, all right.
So it's not as common as it used to be.
Everybody understand what I'm talking about?
Well, we used to, but then it got to be redundant because that's already covered by the UDC. So that's when it was taken out.
I see yeah. The commissioners probably more likely to do it in the last 5 years than the planning mm-hmm. commission. And I haven't.
Which is the board that I sit through their meetings. Is that what you're suggesting, Tom? So why don't you take this and go to them? Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I agree with that. And it's been an issue for years. And I'm not crazy about the practice just because it's already in the UDC, we already forbid it, then why do we need to duplicate it in the zoning condition? And invariably what will happen is we'll change or mix up a comma accidentally, and now we've got a conflict between our UDC and the zoning condition. Just leave it out. If it's forbidden in the UDC, there's no need to go through it.